My name is Karen Luzius, and we are at the Festival Beach Food Forest in Austin, Texas. And we're going to talk about the ecological design of the food forest.
Not only are we a food forest, but this one is special because it is right downtown. And yet, in the food forest, it's like we're in this little pocket. It's this wonderful microclimate. It's cooler, it's quieter, it's got an amazing biodiversity.
We have these different ecosystems that come together right in Austin. Right here in the food forest, we're subtropical. We have very, very, very hot summers here. But the great thing is we have these big, beautiful trees, which are our canopy. We have a lot of shade in this little area in the summer, and it's really amazing how that changes the climate. It is definitely, I'd say, 15 degrees cooler under the trees. The original trees were planted 5 years ago, and since then we've been just continually adding understory. The plants that we select for the food forest are all plants that work together. So they all have an ecological function. When we're planting plants, we are looking at it through the lens of what's edible, what can we provide to the community, what's medicinal, what can we provide in terms of medicine, what can we do to make the park a lovely place for people to connect with nature. So we are selecting as much as possible food and medicine, but we are also selecting plants that are fulfilling an ecological function. We have nitrogen fixers, and we have pollinator plants and nutrient accumulators that reach down and pull the nutrients from the subsoil. And we have plants that make mulch and plants that attract beneficial insects and plants that repel pests. We are a park, so we have to make sure that it looks nice enough to be a park. So we're constantly balancing all those things. So all of that we consider when we are selecting plants. So we have all these different layers in the food forest and all those plants working together, providing different functions to create an ecosystem. And over time, it's really amazing to see what's happened. One of the reasons that we design food forests in layers is because you can get a lot more going on in a smaller space. When you have 7 layers, you're packing it in very efficiently. Like this food forest is 2/3 of an acre, but we have a lot going on here. Right now in the food forest, we have approximately 176 fruit and nut trees, and we have hundreds and hundreds of understory plants. We have the canopy layer. And the canopy layer are the big tall trees, like our tall pecans here. And we have some tall oaks over there. All year, except winter, there's a big, thick canopy of leaves. So this is providing incredible shade. Everywhere in the food forest are all these little microclimates that allow things to thrive that wouldn't necessarily thrive. And then there's an understory layer. We have all these fruit trees.
We have a pear tree and figs. And over here we have this beautiful elderberry, peach trees, mulberry trees. There's a mimosa, which is also medicinal.
This is a loquat. They're not native, but they're super happy here and they make a fruit that is delicious.
We also have trees that are nitrogen fixers on every berm. Like this is a golden ball lead tree, which is this gorgeous tree that's a nitrogen fixer.
Then we have a shrub layer. The shrub layer is probably the biggest layer in the food forest. We have shrubs like beautyberry. These will be purple berries. This is also native. And then kidneywood, and this is a native also, and it's a wonderful pollinator. We have some hawthorns. This is hibiscus, This is the kind of hibiscus that you make hibiscus tea out of. This one is a mallow called Texas mallow. We have things like agarita, a shrub that grows in the hill country. We have an herbaceous layer. So a lot of our perennial herbs are in that layer. We have culinary herbs and we have a lot of medicinals. Different kinds of calendula growing all over the medicine berm. We grow a lot of yarrow. And we have comfrey and coneflower and sage and all kinds of different herbs. We plant okra and also artichokes, peppers, basil, things like that. We have so much lamb's quarter and it is abundant food, especially in the summer. Down here we have garlic chives, which is a perennial vegetable. We have French sorrel all over this berm. Those are both perennials. Around the corner, we have a big patch of asparagus. We've got lots of native milkweeds as well for the monarchs and other kinds of butterflies. Then we have a ground cover layer. And the ground cover is for weed suppression and it covers the ground and keeps it cool. We have cover crops that are nitrogen fixers and edible. A lot of our herbs are sort of like ground covery. This is prairie verbena. And then these are pink evening primrose. And then we have things that reseed. We have a lot of peppermint right here. And we have all these Austrian winter peas. We have a root layer of plants that are under the ground. We grow things like daikon radish, turnips and onions, white carrots, sweet potatoes. You can eat them if you choose, or you can just cut them off and let them rot in the soil and just become part of that rich ecosystem. And then our last layer is the vine layer. So we have passion flower vines. Passion flowers make wonderful medicine, but it's also the host plant for the Gulf fritillary butterfly. So all summer long, we have orange caterpillars and orange butterflies just circling it. We also have cultivated grapes. We have a whole grape walk. So we have all kinds of things growing here. There's an abundance of biodiversity. There's an abundance of food. There's an abundance of medicine. And there's always things that you can eat. The community aspect of it is huge. We are reclaiming this as a public commons. It is definitely a community of people and it's also a community of plants. It's about those interactions and those relationships. Indigenous cultures have been doing this for thousands and thousands of years. It is ancient wisdom, you know, and we're just like getting back to it.